Amen. All right. My name is Corey, and I'm the campus pastor here. I have the privilege and the honor of opening the word with you. So if you don't mind, we actually have some Bibles kind of scattered throughout under the chairs and little baskets. And if you want to grab those, I think Jim let you know on your way in, 1 Corinthians 15. That's where we're going to be. If you want to turn there in the Bibles we have here, that would be on page 933. And we're going to spend our time in that passage this morning. As a church, we're going through a series right now called Unashamed. It comes from a verse in the Bible that an individual is saying, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It's the power of God for salvation. And so we are going to spend the next few weeks thinking about, talking about, and applying the gospel to our hearts and lives. And then after this series wraps up, we're going to go into an extended time where we begin to look at some of the Old Testament stories and how the gospel is present there. And so, just so you're aware, this is kind of what gets me excited. Like the idea of the gospel and finding it in scripture and spending time reflecting on it, that is something that I'm very passionate about. And that wasn't always the case. In fact, when I started into ministry in the early 2000s, this really wasn't a big deal for me. It was something. I know I was aware of the gospel. I know that I felt like it would probably be what we needed to share with people. I wanted to reach people who the church would struggle to reach. And I think the gospel was definitely a feature in my life and ministry. But right around 2007, God began to do some things in my own story where he was really just changing me in a variety of ways. But one of the things that kind of came to the surface through that season of life was the reality that the gospel is it, man. The gospel is it's everything. It is, as the kids say, gospel is life, man. It's just what is, it's the thing at the very center of Christianity, and it is the thing that we need to spend our time reflecting on and just falling in love with. The gospel is the good news of what God has done in the sending of his son, and it isn't just the entry point into Christianity. It's the A to Z. It's the whole thing. It's the deal, man. So we're going to spend our time rehearsing the gospel to each other. But let's go ahead and pray, and then we'll get to work. Lord, we pray right now that you, God, would speak to us. We don't want to hear the opinions of a dude up front. We don't just want to sit here and listen to a message. We want to encounter the living God, and we believe that you will speak through your word by your spirit, and that you can accomplish what you want to accomplish. And so, Lord, I pray as a messenger, I pray, Lord, that I would be faithful in delivering what you want me to say. I pray, Lord, that you would help me to fade into the background and for your son, Jesus, to come into the foreground. Help us, Lord, to fall in love with who he is and what he has done. Help us as a community of faith to rally around this central and important reality of the gospel. Help us, Lord, as we spend our time this week and in the coming weeks, help us to fall in love with the beautiful message of your saving grace in the sending of your son, your gospel. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. 1 Corinthians 15 is a part of the Bible where the gospel is kind of highlighted, where Paul just spends a few minutes kind of reminding us, here's what it is. And there's several different elements. And in fact, I've kind of pulled out 12 different realities of the gospel from this text. And so I'm going to walk you through that. And we're going to go through this kind of step by step. But we're going to look at all of these different realities that are here in the gospel. So the first one is that the gospel needs to be rehearsed. If you look with me at verse 1, Paul says this, "Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you." So Paul, the author here, he was an individual who was a missionary church planter. He would go to different locations and he would get people together. He would go into their meetings and he would begin to preach the message of salvation through faith in Christ. He would gather people together. He would proclaim this message. And as people would come to believe in that, they'd gather together. He'd appoint elders. They'd have a church then, and he would peace out. Sometimes he'd only be there for 3 weeks. Sometimes he'd be there for a year and a half. But this was kind of what he would do. He would start a church by preaching the message of the gospel and gathering those people who respond by faith. And then he would peace out and begin the process all over again. And that's just what he did. He just did that all over the place. And he would go, he would travel and do this and inconvenience himself because he believed that this is what life is all about, letting people know the saving message of the gospel and getting them plugged in to the local church. So here, he's already been with this group of people. And often when he pieces out, he will write letters back to help them, to coach them up and help them know how to behave as a church and how to live under the gospel of God's grace. And so he's writing to them, and what he says is, I want to remind you. I want to remind you of the gospel that I preached to you. So he spent a bunch of time helping them to understand what they need to do, how to organize their church services, how to do all this different stuff. But he says, but here's what's really important that you understand, and he does this to almost every church. You need to know, you need to be reminded of the gospel. I want to remind you of the gospel that I preached to you because that is so foundational. For them to do anything as the people of God, they need to draw their attention back to the beauty of the gospel and let all of their activities flow out of that. The gospel is that a dynamic force of God that changes us and that inspires us and that saves us. And so he wants them to remember the gospel. So the first thing that I'm drawing out from this text is that the gospel needs to be rehearsed. It's not something that we say once on the front end of, let's say, a members class, and we go, okay, you got to make sure you know this, but then we're going to move on and do a bunch of other cool stuff. No, the gospel is the thing that we just keep going back to over and over and over and over again. Last night, Ash, my wife, she was asking me, hey, what are you preaching on tomorrow? I said, my eyes lit up. I'm like, the gospel? She goes, don't you do that every week? I'm like, yes, I do. And I hope that that's always the case, that we're always, when we get together, proclaiming the gospel. But this week, we get to specifically hone in on what it is and some of the features of it. The gospel is the thing we need to be reminded of over and over and over again. Not just once a week either. Last night, we were out at my parents' house and got two kids, and my daughter is the older one. She's 4 years old, and she loves Grammy and Papa and hanging out with her cousins, and they got a bounce house out there now that they just put up in like just a common area in their house, and so they have this bounce house that all the kids are flying in and out of, and I'm telling Reese, hey, we got to get going. I've got some work to do for tomorrow, and she's like, uh-uh, I want to stay here. I want to spend the night. I want to do this, so I'm trying to get her ready and trying to put on these shoes that are impossible to put on. And so I'm like pulling on them, and she doesn't want to leave. So she's like flipping her foot around. And I'm like, oh, and I just feel the frustration in me. I don't know if you've ever been there before, but I just feel this frustration in me. You're embarrassing me. And I just want to get this thing on. And I'm starting to sweat, and now I'm uncomfortable. And I'm like, oh, come on, get this. And I get it on. And I begin to realize, we're driving home, and I begin to realize, man, I kind of blew it in that moment. Like, as a parent, I don't want to parent out of frustration, and I don't want to parent out of, you need to do this because this is what I want to do, right? Which is often the case, and regardless of how my kids are behaving, I don't want to be the one who says, you have to do this because this is what I want. And the way that I was interacting with my daughter, as I was thinking about it, I was like, that wasn't good. I got angry with her, I got frustrated, I got embarrassed, and so I apologized to her. And here's what I was thinking. I need the gospel for ordinary parenting moments. Like, I need to be somebody who understands God's love for me. I need to be somebody who, at the core of who I am, I'm just confident in how God has been very patient with me. And there have been lots of moments where I'm kicking my foot around going, I don't want to do that, God. And God's been very patient with me and very deliberate with me. And I want to parent out of an overflow of the gospel and understanding who I am in Christ. And I need the gospel then last night, and I need it this morning, and I need it every day. Like, I need the gospel to be reminded to me so that I can live out of it. And I think the same is true for all of us. If we all need the rehearsal of the gospel to happen all the time, because we want to be a people who aren't just reacting to life, but we're actually intentionally thinking through, how does the gospel apply to me, and how does it affect my attitude and my emotions and how I do life. The gospel is something that needs to be rehearsed. Paul says to them, I want to remind you of this. And I want to say that to you. I want to remind you of the gospel. You come to church, if we don't highlight the gospel at some point, I don't think we're doing our job. I want to remind you of the beautiful message of what God has done in the sending of his son. That's the first one there. The gospel needs to be rehearsed. The second thing that I see here is that the gospel is personal. It's not just a concept, it's not just an idea, but it's something that we need to personally respond to. Look at verse 1 halfway through it. This gospel that I preached to you which you received and on which you've taken your stand. So this group of people, he's saying, I want to remind you of the gospel, and here's what's true of it. It was something you personally received. You heard that message, and you applied it by faith to your own life, and you began to build your life then on the truth of that message. You took your stand on it. You put your neck on the line in this first century when they would associate with the Christian church. They would be putting themselves in harm's way and out of step with the rest of society. And he's going, look, I appreciate about you that when I proclaim the gospel to you, you heard it, you received it, and you began to organize your life around this truth. And so we need to be people who personally hear that message and personally respond to that message and then build our lives out of it. Having done student ministry for a number of years, it's a truth that I often talk to students about. You can grow up around the church. You can go to church and hear things hundreds and hundreds of times. But it's very important that at some point in your life, you make it your own. You make it personal. You don't just hear the message and go, yeah, that's what we do. I'm a Christian. But you hear that message and you receive it. You say, this is mine. This is God's love for me. This is what God has done for me. This is the forgiveness that I have in Christ, and it's mine, and I love it. It has to be personal. We have to receive it, and we have to build our lives upon it, and I hope you'd be willing to let the gospel be the thing that you take your stand on. There are a lot of things that you can give your life to, a lot of passions, a lot of hobbies, a lot of things that can get you excited, but I hope that you will become a person who, when you think about the gospel, you go, that's the thing I build my life upon. That's the thing I would stand on. That's the thing I would suffer my reputation for or my career. I stand on the gospel, and I stand firmly. So the gospel is something that needs to be rehearsed. It's also something that is personal. And then third, I see here that the gospel is the saving message of God. Verse 2, by this gospel, you are saved. The gospel is the message of God sending his son, and that those who place their faith in him experience salvation. So he tells the church there, he goes, this is the message that saves you. The Bible is very clear that we are a people who need saving. Now, when you hear that for the first time, that's offensive. That's like telling someone you're doing it wrong. And the Bible keeps reminding us you are dead in your sins. And so therefore, you're not just going to kind of wake yourself up. You're a slave to sin. You're not just going to liberate yourself. You're an enemy of God. The Bible, because it tells us about our rebellion against our Maker and our ignoring of him through all the things in life, it's telling us that's the biggest problem that you have, is that you need saving. You are out of step with what you were made for. And the Bible says there is a way to be saved. There's a way to be reconciled. There's a way to be right with God. And it is by faith in the Son of God. It is the message of the gospel. And he says, the message of the gospel then is the saving work of God. And so we got to be people who love that then. We got to be people who recognize we're saved individuals. If you're a Christian, you're a saved individual who has the ability to help other people come back into a right relationship with God. So the message of the gospel is the message of salvation. But that salvation is not mechanical. Look at the end of verse 2. If you hold firmly to the word I preach to you. Otherwise, you have believed in vain. It's the message that saves you if you hold firmly to the word that was preached. Otherwise, it's possible that you have believed in vain. And it's reminding us that we have this responsibility not just to interact with the message kind of on a superficial level and go, yeah, I believe that. But it's something that we need to hold firmly to. There's something that we need to build our lives upon, as I've already said, but you're holding on to it and saying, this is what I need. This is what I constantly need. I'm holding firmly to it, to this message that's been preached. There are people who, having heard the message and having claimed to believe, don't actually believe the message of salvation. As I worked with students for a number of years, there were certain times where a student would come into the youth group and I could begin to see their life changing. They were making big decisions. They were getting excited about youth group. They were coming on the youth events. They were doing all this stuff. And then the tragic part is that there are certain students who went through that process, but then at some point they just gave it up. They just quit pursuing the things of God. And then they went back to their former way of life, and they began to get right back into bad habits and patterns and rejection of their Maker. And that just reminds me, the message of salvation is available to anybody, and it is powerful and effective, and it does save people. But it's important that we remind ourselves, We need to hold firmly to that message. We need to keep pressing into that reality, and we need to do what we can with our lives to make that a habit and a routine, to just constantly revisit the beauty of God's saving work for us. So thirdly, the gospel saves, and then fourthly, we see here that the gospel is received. It's received. It's something that Paul had inherited, if you will. It's something that had been given to him, and he had a responsibility then to be faithful to it. Look at verse 3. For what I received, I passed on to you. So he had received the message, and now he's going to pass it along to other people. But what I want to show you here is that the gospel is given. It's not something that Paul gets to make up. And it's not something that Paul gets to try to adjust to make it more beautiful. The gospel is something that he has been given. And then his responsibility as a minister of the gospel is to take that message and to try to relay it to other people. But we need to hear that, because the truth is we like to take the message of the gospel and then try to adjust it. In fact, back in the early 2000s, when I was just getting into ministry, a lot of the popular Christian people at that point were really gaining their popularity because the way they would present the messages. There was this trend toward being new and novel. There was a trend toward taking these old truths and then trying to make them, like, beautify them and make them provocative and make people hear them in a new way. And I remember as a young person just being like riveted by that. Like, wow, this is so awesome. I've been to church my entire life, but now I'm hearing it in this way, and I've never really thought of it like that before. And so that was kind of the initial stages of my ministry. I thought, that's what I need to do. I need to take this message, and I have to be creative, and I have to be compelling, and I have to be provocative, and I have to present it in a way where people are going to go, wow, I've never thought of that before. That's so cool that you can present it that way. And then God kept working on me, and I began to see, no, that is not at all what gospel ministry is about. You are given a message, and the responsibility then of a gospel messenger is to take that message and accurately relay it. Now, you certainly have to do that in a way where it's going to be acceptable to people. You have to communicate it in a way that they're going to hear it and understand it. But it's not my job to try to make it more compelling. It's not my job to be creative with it, to try to make it better than it might sound initially. My job is to be faithful. So it's kind of like telephone, you know, when you play that game and somebody says, hey, here's the message, and they start to whisper it around, and you get to the end and you go, what'd you hear? And then you compare it to the beginning and you go, wow, that is crazy how as you went around, it just changed, it morphed. Or telestrations, I don't know if you guys have ever played that one before. It's like telephone, it's a game that you play, and you have a phrase. Josh and Mel, we were playing this a couple years ago with a handful of other people, and I was laughing so hard because you have a phrase, and then you say it to the person next to you, and then they draw it. And then they pass their little notebook to the next person, and they have to translate what they think the phrase might have been. And as you're going through it, and then you get to the end, and you find out, no, here's what we started with, and all of a sudden we're dealing with some weird stuff. I mean, I don't even know where this stuff came from. But I think church can sometimes be like that, where we hear this message and we go, all right, guys, well, let's brainstorm, let's draw something cute, let's try to figure out how to make this thing even better. And we start doing that, and before we know it, we start to check against the original. And we go, man, this is nowhere near what God has intended for us. We're communicating a message, but we're so far off track. And I guess what I'm saying here is, this is something that I feel. I want to be faithful to what's been given. This is the gospel that I have received. It's not something that I get to fabricate. It's not something that I get to try to improve upon. My job, as I understand it, is to be faithful. That I know what God says, and I put it forward, and I just make sure I want it to be clear. I want it to be compelling. I want it to be beautiful. But my job is to make sure that it's clear and that it's accurate. And for you, you know, as you think about the gospel message, just know it is a message that has been committed to the people of God, that you also get to be a carrier and a distributor of this gospel message. So for you as well, be sure that you keep going back to what God has given us in his word. It is a message that is given, that is received. Fifthly, I see here that the gospel is meant to be passed along. Verse 3, what I received, I passed on to you. Paul recognizes that the gospel message is not something for him to just sit on. It's not that he's going to sit around. You know, he's a great theologian, he's an author, he's a writer. He doesn't just sit there and go, you know what I'm going to do with my life? I'm just going to spend my life sitting here reflecting on the gospel. No, he believes that the gospel is a message that is dynamic and needs to be spread out, that it needs to be passed along, that people need to hear the message of God's saving work and the sending of the Son of God. It's a message that people need to be aware of, and so Christians ought to be people who are passing this message along. I've told you from the beginning of our campus that I do not want this to be a place where the gospel proclamation is kind of fenced in to this little time that we have. I don't think this is the only place where people need to hear the gospel. I really do hope that we can become a community of faith where ordinary, everyday Christians are going to work as messengers of the gospel, passing along the truth of God's love for people. That we would, tomorrow morning, we would cruise off to work and we would go with this sense of identity and the sense of purpose and the sense of mission, because we know God has given to us a message of the gospel, and we want to share that with as many people as possible. And we're looking for and praying for opportunities then to let that message be known. It's a message that needs to be passed along. We don't just want it here. We don't just want to sing about it. We don't just want to rehearse it to each other week by week. We want to recognize this is a message to be shared. And I hope that we can become a people who are equipped and trained to do that every week, every day, ordinary stuff, ordinary conversations about this beautiful message of salvation. Number six, the gospel is a matter of first importance. Look at verse 3. I passed on to you this gospel as of first importance. So when Paul thinks about the gospel, he goes, this is it. This is the primary thing to be done. I don't know if you guys have morning rituals. I certainly do. There are things that happen in the morning that if they don't happen, the rest of the day is shot. Like, for instance, my teeth. Like, that's step number one. I just want that weird funk gone, right? I want my breath to be clear, not stinky, whatever. So I brush my teeth, go to the bathroom, wash my hands. Then I make a pot of coffee. Like, this is just first important stuff, right? These things have to happen for the day to be worth anything. Make coffee, start drinking it. Do my time in the Word, spend some time together with God in prayer and reading, and then I shower. I don't know if you guys are like me, but I don't really wake up until that happens. Like, I'm not fully ready for a day until I shower. And so if I have to, for whatever reason, skip that, the kids are up, Harrison's climbing something, and I'm like, I can't do this today, my kid might die. If I skip that shower, then the rest of the day just doesn't feel right. And I never fully get to the place where I feel like I'm awake and productive and energized. I just feel like I'm walking around like a stinky funk. But that's the point, that there are these things that need to be first, that need to be primary, that need to come right away. And the gospel is that thing for us as Christians. It's the thing that we have to lead with. It's not something we add in later and we go, look, we're going to try all this stuff. Oh, by the way, we should probably think about the gospel a little bit. No, the gospel is what we lead with. It's the primary thing. So we think about ministries and all that we need to accomplish as a campus. We don't go, well, let's do all that fun stuff and then let's try to bring the gospel into it later on. The gospel is the thing that we go, whatever it is that we're going to do, whether it's serving our community, whether it's going on mission trips, whether it's creating outreach opportunities, whatever ministry projects that we engage in, we're going to start with the gospel. We're going to start with this matter of first importance. What has God done for us in the sending of his Son? Okay, how does that inform everything else? It's first importance. It's something that we have to get settled right on the front end. This is what we do. This is what we care about. Everything else is going to flow out of it. And if we put this first, the other things will be healthier. The other things will be better. So it is a matter of first importance. It's a matter of first importance for our church. It needs to be a matter of first importance for you as a Christian. That you would wake up and you would begin to think, what has God done for me? What has God done for me in his beautiful gospel? And learn to be a person who, that's just kind of how you translate life. I was meeting with a buddy and we were talking through this and we were just thinking through, there are so many realities that the gospel accomplishes. And so it's inexhaustible. You're never going to be like, well, this is redundant. We're talking about the gospel again. It's so beautiful and so compelling and so inexhaustible that you can spend your entire life trying to lead with this thing and just let every part of your life reflect the beauty of it, and you'll never run out of material, and it'll never grow old. It is that incredible. Number seven, the gospel is, and I'm not even sure how to say this. I'm just going to put it this way. The gospel is Christ. It's Him. The gospel is what Christ has done, his death, his burial, his resurrection, but at the end of the day, it's him. Look with me at verses 3 and 4. Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. So now he's defining the gospel. And he's saying, here's what it is. Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was buried, and he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. So when Paul is trying to explain, here's what this thing is, he says, it is Christ. It was his willingness to die in our place for our sins. It was the fact that he was buried according to the scriptures. It was the fact that he was raised according to the scriptures. It is Christ. At the end of the day, when we talk about the gospel, we're not just talking about a concept. We're talking about a person. And for me, this is an area that I'm continuing to grow in, because sometimes I think about the gospel, but I don't think about my Lord. I think about the benefits of the gospel, but I don't always connect the dots that I am really talking about Christ. I'm talking about a person. And we need to be people who just, we never divorce those two, but we keep bringing them together and going, look, whatever the gospel is, it is Him. It's on account of Him. So I was thinking about how to explain this. And, you know, if you think about a diamond and all of the different facets of it, and you were to look at it and examine it and fall in love with the beauty of it, and you go, look at how the light shines this way, and look at this, and look at this. And then you begin to kind of think through, okay, what can I do with a diamond? I can cut stone. I can cut things with diamond. I could use it to propose. There's so many benefits to this. It's valuable. And you talk about this thing, and sometimes that's what we do with Christ. We go, look at all these different realities here, and look at what he can do for us. But at the end of the day, we have to go, and this is a beautiful diamond. Like this is it. Like this is what, not just what it can do for us, not just, you know, how it affects things, but ultimately we look at it and we go, the gospel is Christ. It is what he has done for us. It is the beauty of his willingness to die in our place, be buried and rise from the dead. And it is him. Christ is it. John Piper, he's one of my favorite pastors and authors. And in a book called God is the Gospel, he talks about heaven, and he asks a really hard, really pressing question. And it goes something like this. I'm just paraphrasing, because I don't have it in my notes, but he says, look, if you could have all of the good things, if you could go to heaven and have all of your friends there, all of the stuff you love, if you could have all of the things you enjoy eating, all of the beauties that you just, when you think about things that are good and noble and excellent, they're there. And he goes, if you could have all of that, but Christ weren't there, could you be satisfied with heaven? That's a good question. And many of us go, wow, yeah, I'd love all that stuff. But Christians are people who go, no, if Christ were not there, I could not be satisfied, because he is it. He's the treasure. When we talk about the gospel, we're not just talking about the benefits and the blessings of it and how it can affect us, but we're talking about Christ. And we need to be people who fall so in love with him that he's what we want. And we recognize that he is the source and the fountain of all the blessings that we have. So you subtract him from it, you lose everything. He's it, man. He is the gospel. Number eight, the gospel is biblical. Look with me at verses 3 and 4. Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was buried and he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. You hear that phrase? According to the scriptures. The message is a message that we find in a book. It's a message that God has given to us, and he's written it down. So we become people who constantly go to a book to hear about this message. Now, I don't know how you feel about that, because I know we're living in a non-book society. We're living in a day and age where we don't deal with printed material very much anymore. And then to recognize that Christians are people of a book is kind of strange and weird. And so I hope that what we do here at our campus is helpful. In fact, it's pretty deliberate. We've got this huge screen behind me. I mean, this thing is massive. And the projector behind it is not a cheap projector. It's this huge amount of money that we forked out to be able to have this equipment here. And we have a graphic designer at the Beloit campus. So one of the things that I could have done, that I could do week by week, is just submit my sermon notes to the graphic designer, and get that all plugged in, and we could just put them up on the screen. Week by week, I could come up here. We could do our message time. You could just peek at it behind me. You don't even have to look down. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to open a book. You just look back here. But what have we done? We said, look, we're going to buy some Bibles, and we're going to put them under the chairs. And every week when I'm preaching, I'm just going to tell you, grab a Bible. And I'm going to tell you what page it's on. And I'm going to walk you through it. And I'm going to keep pointing to it and go, look here. Look what this verse says. Look what this verse says. And these Bibles, man, they first off, they weren't cheap, but also they're super heavy. Like, we put those things in that cart over there, and it almost breaks people's backs as they're trying to push it into the trailer. But we said, look, this is something that we want. We want our people, if this is the only time they're opening a book, we want it to happen here at church. We want to get you familiar with, okay, here's a Bible. Oh, yeah, that's what it looks like. Oh, this is what it feels like to hold a book again. And then we start working our way through it. And the way that I preach is so that I'm drawing your attention to the Bible. I'm trying not to draw attention to me. I'm just saying, hey, what do you see here? Verses 5-8. Look at this. Look at this. So that at the end of the day, you're gaining confidence in the message and you're seeing it in the book. You're seeing it from God's word because the gospel is biblical. It's something that God has given us in his book. And I hope then that if we keep doing this, you just get more and more accustomed to it. Week by week, you're doing it. You open your Bible. Okay, I can do this. You start to get a sense of, maybe I could do this at home, right? Maybe I could read a Bible for myself. How crazy is that? I could go home and open up a Bible and begin to read it and see the beauty of the gospel there. If that happens, I'm all for it. And that's one of the deliberate things that we're doing here. We want you to realize the gospel is biblical and it is for you. So I hope that you would read your Bibles. Number 9. The gospel is historical, and you can check it out. Look at verses 5-8. Christ appeared to Cephas, that's Peter, then to the 12, the other disciples. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time. All of the followers of Christ present in the first century that were there after the death, burial, and resurrection, he appears to them. And he says, most of them are still living at the time of his writing. Most of them are still alive, though some have fallen asleep, which means they've passed away. Then he appeared, Christ appeared to James, then to all the apostles. And last of all, he appeared to me also as to one abnormally born. He's saying, this really happened. Like, this isn't just a concept. It's not just an idea. It is a historical event. There was a man, Jesus, and he was crucified. They buried him, but he came back from the dead. How crazy is that? And not just he came back from the dead, but over the course of 40 days, he spent time with people. There are numbers of people who've interacted with him. And if you want to know if this is for real, you can go talk to them. At the time of this writing, he's basically challenging them. If you don't think this really took place, go ask somebody who was there. Try to find out if you really think this happened or not. And now, thousands of years later, we still have that sort of influence when we think about the gospel message. There is a reality that this was a historical event that is hard to silence. Like, if you're an atheist, this is really problematic for you. You look at all the historical records and what happened with this man and how he died and he came back from the dead, and you try to just dismiss that or silence that, you got a lot of work to do. This is big time. The truth of what happened, the historical reality of Christ dying and coming back from the grave, is significant. And if you believe that, then it should give you greater confidence. You can check it out for yourself. There's plenty of first century writing around this, and also 4 different accounts in the Bible itself to help you know we're not making this stuff up. It's real. Check it out for yourself. So the gospel is a historical thing that you can check out for yourself. And then he points out that the apostles themselves, the ones who wrote the New Testament, they were there. So when you read anything in the New Testament, you should have confidence. Here's number 10. The gospel rescues the unlikely. The gospel is able to rescue people who you might not anticipate would be rescued. When he's thinking about himself, he says at the end of verse 8, he says, one who is abnormally born, talking about his entrance into faith. And then in verse 9, he says, for I'm the least of the apostles and do not even deserve to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. When he thinks about himself and the fact that he is now an ambassador of this message, he goes, look, I don't even deserve this. Before I became a Christian, I was going around doing everything I could do to prevent people from following Christianity. I was trying to destroy the church. And when I met Christ, it changed everything, and I became a champion of his message and his way. And so when we think about the gospel, we need to be careful, because sometimes we write people off. And we go, no, they'd probably never listen to this. They'd probably never, I can't even imagine what it would look like if they were saved. There are people in my life that I have that tendency, I kind of write them off. And this reminds me, the gospel is so powerful that it can save the unlikely. It can save the people that you might have given up hope on. The gospel can save even the most unlikely. Russ Moore, he tweeted one time talking about one of the greatest evangelists in our day and age, Billy Graham. And he said, look, the next Billy Graham might be hung over in a bar somewhere right now. Like the next most effective, one of the most effective ministers of the gospel could be somebody that you would write off, that you would dismiss, that you would think there is absolutely no way. If you were to look at Saul before he became Paul, he'd be that guy. You'd go, no way, he hates the church. He persecutes the church. Here's how powerful the gospel is. When the gospel comes to bear on somebody's heart and life, it changes everything. It doesn't matter what their story is. The gospel is that cool. It is that powerful. Number 11, the gospel is effective. Look with me at verse 10. By the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God that was in me. Here's what Paul's doing here in verse 10. He's reminding us that the gospel is effective. He's pointing to his own life, and he goes, look, I am who I am because of God's incredible gospel. I don't deserve to be an apostle. I don't deserve to be a missionary church planter, but I am what I am. And this gospel of grace is powerful. It wasn't without effect. In fact, it changed me. So when I think about what God has done for me, I'm highly motivated. I work my butt off. He's saying, I work harder than any of the other apostles because I recognize what God has done for me. I realize how incredible it is that I'm saved, and so I get to work. The gospel doesn't make you lazy. It makes you ambitious. And he's saying the gospel is that effective. It is changing my life, and I'm working because I want people to know the beauty of the gospel. And then he's able to say, but listen, even when I'm working as hard as I can, it's not to my credit. It's the grace of God in me. The gospel is effective. It will change who you are. It'll change how you do life. It'll change how motivated you are to do the things of God. It'll give you a gospel humility where you just know, I am who I am by the grace of God, and I'm comfortable with that. I can live in my own skin. I don't have to try to be someone else or have their gifts. I just do what God has called me to do. I can work really, really hard and have a gospel confidence knowing God is going to work through me. And I can be okay with it at the end of the day because I know that it is God's power working in me. The gospel is effective. Here's the last one. The gospel is the goal. The gospel is the goal. When Paul thinks about this, he's not thinking, how can I make myself better? And how can I make myself more known for being a gospel minister? In fact, look at verse 11. He's been comparing himself to the other apostles, and he's going, here's who I am. Here's what I've done. I work harder than them, but nonetheless, it's God's grace in me. Then verse 11, whether then it is I or they, this is what we preach, and this is what you believe. This is phenomenal to me because I know my own heart. Paul thinks about gospel ministry, and he's not only thinking about his brand. He's not simply trying to build his platform. He's able to say, it doesn't matter if it's me up there preaching the gospel to you or somebody else. It's not about me. It's about the gospel. So for me, whether it's me up here or somebody else, I want to celebrate when the gospel is proclaimed. I want to be able to celebrate wherever it is that I see the beauty of the gospel being proclaimed to the people. That's hard. When we were launching this campus, we were on the exact same timetable as another church that ended up heading a little further south into Rockford. But initially, we're looking at all the same buildings. We had the same launch date stuff going on. And it was one of those experiences where I know the dude and we spent some time together and we had coffee, but I had to get to the point where I was able to say, it doesn't matter whether it's us or you. If the gospel is preached, we will rejoice. And there are other churches right now that are launching new campuses and looking at facilities around here and in other places that we know and love. And we need to be able to say, it doesn't matter. It's not about our brand. We're not trying to build our reputation or our platform or our community, our church community. We're able to say, look, as long as the gospel is being preached, if it's being proclaimed, we rejoice. And if we don't get credit for it, that's fine. God does. We need to be people who have been so radically changed by the gospel that even the way that we think about life and ministry is being changed. The gospel is beautiful, isn't it? I'm going to invite the band to come up, and we're going to worship. And I just want to challenge you in this moment. If you've never personally responded to the gospel, today's your day. Talk to me. Talk to one of our team members. This is too beautiful to walk away from. Trust in him. Believe in what Christ has done for you. Receive his grace and his forgiveness. Receive eternal life. If you are a believer in the gospel, make this your matter of first importance. Let the gospel be the thing that you just build your life upon. It's worth it. It's beautiful. And let's let it be the thing that drives our entire church. So I'm going to pray, and then we're going to stand and worship our King, the King of the gospel. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for loving us so well that you sent your Son. Thank you for the gospel that you've given to us. Help us, Lord, to be a community of faith that just loves what you've done for us. Lord, let the beauty of that truth transform who we are. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.